Ta ham godt imot Charlie Siem.
Hello there.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
I said Charlie. Your full name is Charles Maximilian.
Charles Maximilian. A very grand name.
It's wonderful.
Yeah, thank you.
It's not very Norwegian, though.
No, that's right. I almost had a slightly more Norwegian name. When I was born, my father, who's Norwegian, said, why don't we call him Nordmann?
Nordmann, yeah. Oh, that's a great name.
Yeah, it's a strong, very Viking, great name. But my mum, being English, said, we're not calling my son Norman the Doorman. So luckily I got Charlie.
So what's left of the Norwegian in you? Do you like eat Norwegian food?
We always had, as when I was a kid, my dad, the sort of slap-up meal would be fiskeboller, med hvitsaus. And then when we're feeling very, very posh, we would have karpers on the hvitsaus. That was when it was a fancy evening. So yeah, so Norway for me, absolutely, it's the food, these dishes that are so well known.
A Swede would never say that Norway was known for its food.
No, I know. This is the first time I hear it.
Yeah, this is very refined Norwegian cooking. I mean, fiskeboller, kransekake, pølsemelumpe.
Yes, very good.
What would Norway be without those things? That's what I want.
Yeah, that is true.
Tell me, how did you choose your instrument? I mean, you started out so young.
Yeah, well, it's one of those things where I think the violin chose me as much as I chose the violin. I was a small boy, 3 years old. My mum thought it was great for kids, for the development of the brain. They listened to classical music. So she used to put these cassette tapes in the car. She had a little Volkswagen Golf when we were kids. And I'd sit in the back of the car listening, you know, to classical music. And then this Beethoven violin concerto came on, played by Yehudi Menuhin, who was one of the great icons of the violin in the 20th century. And I heard this melody, very simple melody in the first movement of the Beethoven violin concerto, and I was completely transported. You know, I just said, that's what I got to play. I got to play that theme. And so it was really Beethoven's violin concerto and this beautiful
theme. And you were that young and you thought...
I was like, Mum, you've got to sort this out for me. You know, that was my earliest memory and, you know, the most clear decision that I've made.
It was like... You came from a very musical family either.
No, not at all. Yeah, yeah.
Your father is quite well known in Norway because he's a shipping investor.
Exactly, yeah.
And I don't know, but my idea of that kind of family is that you follow in dad's footsteps.
No, definitely not. You know, and I would never want to go into something where, you know, I'd be the second best. I wouldn't want to go into business and then be in my dad's shadow. Because that's what it would be. You know? I mean, I'm not passionate about, you know, shipping, investing in shipping. You know, I'd have to be as much as I am about the violin to be any good at it. And I think I'd have definitely struggled to be working for my dad and always feeling like I was second best. Whereas here I've gone in a completely different, you know, a different sort of world. And I think my dad respects me for doing that and I can own it, you know.
Are they at all disappointed?
Yeah.
Are they at all disappointed that neither of the siblings have gone into their business?
I mean, they definitely haven't been while we've been growing up. But my dad is actually nearly 70 now. And, you know, he's getting to that point where, you know, maybe he's not going to be doing it as intensely as he has been, you know, when he's been younger. So I think there's an element of thinking, what's going to happen now? And nobody knows.
Wealth can't buy you, money can't buy you talent.
It can't buy you satisfaction, you know. I think, you know, money is... I always think of it like a sculpture, like Michelangelo, when he's trying to like chisel that, you know, these incredible sculptures, you know, the dying slaves or whatever, and he's kind of, you've got a big rough chunk of marble and he's just chipping away and slowly you get to see something more and more polished and more, you get a sense of that, now I can see it's this beautiful muscular form or wherever it is. And I think that's the process of my life. I'm just chipping away, trying to improve, trying to get closer to something that looks okay.
Being a classical performer, it's very much about traveling.
You travel a lot. That's right. Yeah.
And it's also about a lot of practice.
Yeah.
And there's not much time left then.
No, that's true.
What about friendship? What about social life?
Yeah, I mean, it's not an easy life for that sort of thing. You know, it's a lonely life because you're right, I'm constantly moving. And, you know, it's hard to sort of maintain friendships and kind of relationships in one place because I'm only there for a few days, then I'm gone, and who knows when I'm coming back.
But does it make you lonely sometimes?
I don't really get lonely, to be honest. I'm so used to it, you know. Since I was a child, I've been just sitting in my room practicing on my own, so I've not really known anything else.
But you know the concept of friends, right?
Maybe I don't, actually. Maybe that's what it is. So I'm quite satisfied because, you know, I've just never really... I mean, that's not true, actually. Now I'm talking rubbish. Because, I mean, I went to school, I went to university, and I did have, you know, friends around me, and I enjoyed it. When I was there, but
you went to Eton, and you were as far as I know, you went to school with William and Harry, the English prince.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
And that's well, friends. I don't know.
Well, you know, I had other friends.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Okay.
But no.
How much do you get to see?
But I mean, I was in a community. I was living in a house with a bunch of other boys, and you know, there's 1,200 kids at Eton, and I was at Cambridge, and slightly more diverse group of people, perhaps, at Cambridge than they were at Eton. But I had a limited...
What do you say is the biggest misconception about you?
Ooh, God, I don't know. I mean, I think perhaps the sort of idea of the serious musician that I'm trying to be. You know, I've done a lot of things in the kind of fashion world, kind of get things going and, you know...
Doing modelling for very, very famous brands.
Yeah.
Is that risky as a classical performer, if you understand what I mean, for the credibility?
No, absolutely.
As
and like I just
performer.
Said, you know, that obviously people get preconceptions as a result of having done those sorts of things, which perhaps I didn't think enough about at the time. But, you know, I sort of figured I've got to say yes to things. I've got to start, you know, get out there, get some exposure and try to make a name for myself. And it takes very little time. That's the thing. I think the preconception is that, God, he's spending his time... You know, doing the photographs for these campaigns, then how can he be serious at playing the violin? When of course it only takes a couple of hours to take those pictures. And let's say there's one campaign a year, then it's not such a big deal.
So it's
how did that happen? Where did that come from? The fashion thing.
It was very random, actually. It's not. I mean, I've never been a very fashionable person or somebody that was that interested in that world. But I was invited by Mario Testino, the photographer, probably about 7 or 8 years ago. To perform at a book launching he was doing here in London for a book of photographs about Kate Moss. He literally just got in touch and he said, look, I'd really like, I've seen some videos of Charlie and I'd love
very
to come and play.
Very famous photographer, yeah.
He's a very, exactly. Yeah. And so I went, I was like, yeah, great, you know, I can play some Paganini Caprices at this thing, all these glamorous, beautiful people there, so, you know. And then the next day I was invited to feature in this Alfred Dunhill campaign. They were making a sort of winter campaign for this British brand, Alfred Dunhill. They said, look, would you feature in it after having seen me play in this thing? And obviously I said, you know, great. And then one thing basically led to another.
And it's so and much easier than playing the violin.
It is a hell of a lot easier. That's
because
right.
I always wondered that. How hard can it be?
That's it. And you get paid a lot.
They never
ask
me.
But
you've done a lot of modelling, right?
No, not a lot, but I've done some. And I feel the same. I'm... No offense to models or anything, but I'm...
It's very easy.
I feel quite restless when I do it. It's,
No, it's not the most dynamic thing, let's face it. Yeah, it doesn't require that much... anything, really, yeah. But,
thank you so much, Charlie. It's wonderful to have you on
thank
the
you.
Show.
No,
we're
no,
gonna
thank
have
you.
Another guest on.
Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.